Welcome to Money Trail with me, Amir Arafat. Today, $500 billion illegal drug trade, major money laundering banks, and Anglo American Secret Services, the CIA, and MI6.
The global drug trade today is at least $1 trillion a year multinational business. And it's global in scope. You have areas like Afghanistan, where over 90% of the world's opium and heroin is being produced. It's being processed in laboratories in that area of the world and shipped by various routes, sea routes, overland routes, into primary markets in Europe and in North America. You have the same phenomenon with cocaine being produced largely in South American countries, Colombia, Bolivia, and similarly, it's being processed and distributed through a global distribution network.
Drug trafficking is a global illicit trade involving the cultivation, manufacture, distribution, and sale of substances which are subject to drug prohibition laws. At current levels, world heroin consumption stands at 340 tons, and seizures represent an annual flow of 430 to 450 tons of heroin into the global heroin market. Of that total, opium from Myanmar and the Lao People's Democratic Republic yields some 50 tons, while the rest, some 380 tons of heroin and morphine, is produced exclusively from the Afghan opium.
You have drug trafficking out of South America that has primary markets in the United States and in Europe. You had the opium production in what was called the Golden Triangle of Southeast Asia during the time of the Vietnam War. And some of those opium and heroin proceeds went to financing the Indochina War. When that war ended, the opium production shifted to Afghanistan, and now it's been the major source of funding for the wars that have gone on in Central Asia and South Asia for the past 30 years.
The drug capital of the world is not Kabul. It's Washington. It's New York. It's shared capital responsibility. Washington and New York are at the center of global drug trafficking. The major banks are involved. The U.S. government is involved. Other U.S. businesses are involved. The CIA is involved. The global mafia is involved. This is what global drug trafficking is all about.
In 2007 and 2008, cocaine was used by some 60 to 17 million people worldwide. Similar to the number of global opiate users, North America accounted for more than 40% of global cocaine consumption. The total was estimated at around 470 tons. For the North American market, cocaine is typically transported from Colombia to Mexico or Central America by sea and then onwards by land to the United States and Canada.
The government in Colombia has always been crooked, always been in bed with the CIA. The Four Horsemen of Oil are the only companies that make acetone and ethyl ether, which are necessary to produce cocaine. They import that stuff into Colombia freely. Even though U.S. Congress has tried to stop that, they've gotten around it. So all the chemicals necessary to make the cocaine come from U.S. big oil companies. So that basically, in the past, the coca leaf has come out of Bolivia, Peru, different places. Now that Evo Morales is in charge of Bolivia, it's not happening, so they find it somewhere else. But the labs are in Colombia. They're run by the right-wing paramilitaries who are working closely with the Colombian government, the CIA, and the oil companies. The oil companies have a huge presence in Colombia, and they're basically using this Plan Colombia, they call it, to fight a covert war against the FARC and the ELN on behalf of the narco trafficking elite.
All of the funds for this $1 trillion a year multinational business go through the major international banks, and this was made very clear last year when the U.S. Senate Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations produced a report on the HSBC. It's an old British bank formerly known as the Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank. And the U.S. Senate found that HSBC was responsible for laundering somewhere between 60 and 80% of all of the illegal money gained from the global cocaine trafficking, running through banks in Mexico into New York City. So this is an enormous business, and you've got to also consider that there are other criminal enterprises that use the same structure. Illegal trafficking in weapons, illegal trafficking in diamonds, even the white slave trade are all part of a multinational global crime syndicate that has tentacles all over the globe, but ultimately counts on the major international Western banks to handle their finances.
The illegal drug trade and the great powers' involvement in it are nothing new. For a bit of history, let's go all the way to 19th century. The so-called Opium Wars, imposed on China by the British Empire. The Opium Wars, also known as the Anglo-Chinese Wars, are divided into the First Opium War from 1839 to 1842, and the Second Opium War from 1856 to 1860. These were the climax of disputes over trade and diplomatic relations between China under the Qing Dynasty and the British Empire.
Well, remember that the British East India Company was the world's biggest cartel during the time of the American Revolution and into the 19th century. And with the loss of the colonies in North America, the British were desperate to find an alternative source of revenue. And they developed massive opium production in their major colonies in India and used military force to impose the opium trade and opium addiction on the population of China. In the middle of the 19th century, the British East India Company had access to the British Navy, and there were actually two wars fought in China to impose the opium addiction on the Chinese population so that the British East India Company could profit. During that time, a number of big corporations and banks were established, including the Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank, which became the central clearinghouse bank for that Far East opium trade. And what's happened historically in the 20th century is that that opium war policy has continued but has broadened to cover almost the entirety of the planet.
Opium has been known in China since the 7th century, and for centuries it was used for medicinal purposes. It was not until the 17th century that a practice of mixing opium with tobacco for smoking was introduced into China by Europeans, particularly the British. Opium trafficked into China had come from the British East India Company's operations in Bengal, British India, produced at its two factories in Patna and Benares. With the drain of silver and the growing number of people becoming victims of a drug, China's Daoguang Emperor demanded action. In 1838, the Emperor sent Lin Zizhu to Guangzhou, where he quickly arrested Chinese opium dealers and summarily demanded that foreign firms turn over their stocks. In response, the British government sent expeditionary forces from India, which ravaged the Chinese coast and dictated the terms of settlement. The Treaty of Nanking not only opened the way for further opium trade, but ceded territory, including Hong Kong, unilaterally fixed Chinese tariffs at a low rate, granted extraterritorial rights to foreigners in China, which were not offered to Chinese abroad, a most favored nation clause, and diplomatic representation. When the court still refused to accept foreign ambassadors and obstructed the trade clauses of the treaties, disputes over the treatment of British merchants in Chinese ports and on the seas led to the Second Opium War and the Treaty of Tientsin. These treaties, soon followed by similar arrangements with the US and France, later became known as unequal treaties, and the Opium Wars represented the start of China's century of humiliation.
The history has been one of warfare by imperial powers of the West, predominantly the British, to impose opium addiction as a form of social control and enormous profits to keep the empire system going and intact. In 2008, when the entire international banking system froze up as the result of the bankruptcy of Lehman Brothers and the danger of a collapse of all of the major US banks, the major source of funding to keep those big banks operating was criminal money, primarily drug money. And that's just not my opinion. That was the official statement of Dr. Antonio Maria Costa, who at the time was the head of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. So we're talking about a 200-year continuity of opium warfare to fuel the empire's ravenous appetite for money and warfare.
For decades now, Anglo-American secret services, the MI6 and CIA, have been using illegal drug trade money to fund their so-called covert, clandestine, secret operations overseas. From Contras and other rebels in Latin America to Mujahideen in Afghanistan.
The CIA was created in 1947. The Golden Triangle was the center of opium trafficking in the world. Vietnam, Thailand, Laos. This was the hub of global drug trafficking, and the CIA was involved almost from inception, and it stayed involved to this day. It uses drug money to fund its own operation.
Well, one of the best books on the topic, I think, is Heinrich Krüger's The Great Heroin Coup, and he talks about how basically Nixon used the Vietnam War to take over the global drug trade from the French connection, the French mafia. So of course it started out in Southeast Asia and in Laos and Thailand and Burma. They call it Golden Triangle. And during the Vietnam War, huge military conflict. These huge military conflicts seem to go hand in hand with the movement of drugs. So Hong Kong in that case was used as a global money laundry for the drugs coming out of the Golden Triangle. And of course, during a war, it's much easier to smuggle things. So it's a good cover, for drug trafficking. And throughout this, the CIA, of course, got involved with Nixon's CIA. They got involved with Santos Traficante, mobster out of Miami. And he was involved with the Bay of Pigs operation against Castro. And then he also set up operations.
All right, I'm going to cut the video here and continue. Due to the fact that I'm not sure whether I could upload videos beyond 15 minutes. But once again, this is Press TV's Money Trail series. And this particular issue is about the global drug trade. And stay tuned. I will continue to upload these episodes of Money Trail when I have the time to do so. And just stay tuned. A lot more to come. Thanks for watching. God willing, I'll see you in the next video.